Hi, I'm Dr. Ken Miller, and I'm the director of the Adult Cancer Survivorship Program at the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. I'm very fortunate to have with me today Dr. Darin Correll, who is an anesthesiologist and the director of part of the pain service at the Brigham and Women's Hospital, and also an expert on pain issues for people with lung cancer. Darin, thanks for being with us.
My pleasure.
I want to start out by asking about the expression, grin and bear it. So, because I know that's, you know, people talk about that. What do you think of that idea?
Postoperatively, probably not the smartest idea.
Yeah.
You know, there's many things that can be done and should be done. And, you know, to have people think that they just need to accept having pain after surgery is just not true in this day and age. Like I said, there's a number of things that can be done. And the other major issue is that if you have a lot of pain in the initial postoperative period, it can actually lead to long-term pain complications. So you want to try to have your pain as best under control as possible. It also will help speed your recovery the better your pain is controlled.
So you're saying, in a sense, better pain control initially may in fact impact on later recovery.
On long-term recovery, exactly. Not only in the initial period that people will be able to potentially get out of the hospital sooner, but also long-term, it may prevent some long-term complications and problems.
What are some of the barriers to good pain control in the hospital for people with lung cancer or other patients for that matter?
A lot of it is with when the patients don't necessarily realize that there's numerous different modalities and things that can be done.
Mm-hmm.
One of the most important things is for patients to realize that they should tell people when they're experiencing pain. I mean, we do ask them, but they need to be truthful. I mean, many times people can be very stoic,
mm-hmm.
You know, they don't want to bother people, you know, and it's never, certainly never a bother. I mean, we need people to be able to tell us what's actually going on so that we can do things for them appropriately.
How do you measure pain?
In general, most of the time people are going to be asked verbally, what is your pain, with zero being no pain and 10 being the worst pain, and then they'll pick a number in there. Quite honestly, though, the exact number is less important than really the answer to two basic questions is, are you comfortable,
mm-hmm.
and are you able to do the things that you need to do to get better? And those are really the most important things that people need to be able to answer for us to effectively treat them.
So people have surgery, they wake up from the surgery, and they may have pain from the incision itself. How does pain for people that have pain change over time?
So first, I do want to point out that in terms of saying that somebody should have, you know, X amount of pain or X type of pain and last for X period of time,
mm-hmm.
after any given surgery is not correct, because pain is a very individualized, subjective experience. So everyone is going to be very different. But, you know, there are some sort of generalities. One would be, you know, after surgery in the chest, where the chest tubes are, they're going to be experiencing pain. Usually the first 24 to 48 hours are going to be the worst period of time. And then it'll start to subside after that. One place that people don't think about that they are going to have pain after thoracic surgery is actually up in the shoulder area,
mm-hmm.
the shoulder, the neck, the upper back. That can be due to a number of different reasons, including having the chest tube in afterwards. The quality of that pain is usually an ache or a pressure, whereas the other pain is more usually sharp or stabbing, like you would imagine after an incision. After the chest tube comes out, a lot of the pain actually starts to subside, especially the pain up in the shoulder. Now, after discharge, patients may still have a fair amount of pain for several weeks, maybe a month or so. Again, the time is going to vary very individual to individual. Now, the one thing that is important is that after patients are discharged, if at any point their pain is starting to increase,
mm-hmm.
Or it's really not going away, the medicines don't seem to be working, and it's lasting out, you know, weeks and weeks, months, you need to let somebody know, because things, you know, can be done, things need to be adjusted. The other thing to watch out for after discharge, and even in the hospital as well, is if the quality of the pain in the incision is of a burning character or a pins and needles or an electric shock sort of sensation, mm-hmm. again, in and around the incision, especially if it's severe, if it's getting worse, or if the area that's affected is getting bigger, they need to let somebody know. Because what this can be is this may be neuropathic or nerve-generated pain, mm-hmm. and you need to treat that sooner rather than later to prevent it from becoming a long-term problem. And the medications that we use to treat it are going to be different than the normal medicines that you'd be receiving in the post-operative period.
It's almost the same message you were saying before, which is being more aggressive, treating pain actually may have benefit further out.
Exactly, and that's one of the major benefits that I was talking about is trying to prevent the long-term pain complications that can occur after surgery.
Related to this, how can people help themselves?
Basically, the major thing is to let us know. Mm-hmm. You know, as I said before, you know, don't just grin and bear it. Don't, you know, think you're bothering people. You want to be able to truthfully tell us what actually is going on. So that we can do something about it. Now, the other thing is that a number of the different modalities that they may have an epidural mm-hmm. catheter in place. They also will probably be receiving opioids, morphine-like medications, mm-hmm. both of which have a patient-controlled modality to them. So patients should make sure that they understand that and understand how to effectively use those medications to give themselves boluses of the medications. The epidurals do go all the time, but the patient can give themselves a little bit extra whenever they're going to do something that's probably going to kick up the pain. So, you know, if they're going to, you know, cough a lot, if they're going to get up out of bed, walk around, things like that. The opioid medicines that are controlled through the patient-controlled machines, they don't give medication all the time. They only give it when the patient pushes the button. Mm-hmm. The epidurals can be used every 20 minutes. The PCAs, the IV PCAs, can be used every 7 minutes. Now, the one thing is you know, I don't expect people to sit there and stare at the clock trying to figure out exactly when that time has passed. So one of the tricks that I tell people is, even if you don't like watching television, put the television on. Every time a commercial comes on, mm-hmm. think about, do I need to push the button? Because yeah. it at least will give you several times an hour. Because, again, the biggest thing that people can do is to stay on top of it. Mm-hmm. It's much easier to prevent pain than to try to catch up from it. So some people say, you know, oh, I don't want to use medicines. I want to see if I can't use it. They'll wait until they get in severe pain. Bad idea. What often happens is you need to use a lot more medicine then to try to get them caught up, mm-hmm. and then in fact they end up using more than they would have if they would have stayed on top of it.
Right. Okay. Same message, which is that if it's treatable, pain right. is treatable, and treatable successfully, and that treating it actually has benefit beyond just being comfortable. It may make your recovery easier.
Right. Absolutely. Now, you know, sort of to just make sure everyone has realistic and true expectations, in all cases, we may not be able to have patients have zero or no pain at all, constantly, all the time. We're, like I said, we're trying to get them to be comfortable to do the things that they need to do to get better, get up, walk, cough, you know, all those sorts of things. You know, and don't accept that, you know, we'll go in to talk to patients and I'll say, you know, how are you doing? They say, oh, I'm fine. As I just lie here very still and don't take deep breaths. Well, unfortunately, that's not good enough. You need to be able to do those things. So we can get you comfortable enough to do those things. That's the ultimate goal.
And a final question for you. For that group of patients who have longer lasting pain, and one of our earlier speakers talked about post-thoracotomy pain syndrome.
Correct.
What does that feel like, and what can you do about it?
The feeling is what I described before. It's usually sort of a burning or an electric shock. It's described as lancinating, sort of pins and needles. Again, generally, we'll start in the area where the incision was, and then sometimes start to spread out. Again, best thing, sooner rather than later, you need to get on top of it. And there's different types of medications. There's actually medications that are in the general class of anti-seizure medicines, some of the antidepressants, and a couple of other medications are there to be able to treat that and be able to help reduce, certainly at least reduce the burden that it places on the patient long term.
Darin, I want to thank you. This has been really interesting information and important information. Thanks for being with us.
Thanks for inviting me.
I'm Dr. Ken Miller, and this has been another segment of Living Well Beyond Cancer.